And then Prashanth, can you give the next talk?
Thanks.
So this is joint work with Ville, Tuulos, and Flatow. We are from the research center of Nokia in Silicon Valley. And I just kind of outline what I'm going to talk about, which is how Nokia started dealing with data in its research labs, and what prompted the birth of Disco within the research labs of Nokia, and then why we chose Erlang, and what's involved in choosing Erlang, and what our experiences were. This was some time ago, this was before I joined Nokia, but at the time, Nokia as a big company had tons of data on all kinds of services that it runs, scattered across different business units in the company. And there were a group of data analytics and machine learning researchers that were interested in analyzing this data and improving the experience that Nokia's users, dwindling users, were getting and trying to find out why the users were dwindling and trying to do something about it. So the idea was to process all the data from those various services and getting them into one place, and it sounds very simple in theory, but in practice it's very complicated. You've got to deal with administrative boundaries across business units. You've got to worry about getting corrupt files and then refetching them, dealing with changing data formats. Just processing data is half or less than half of the problem. You really have to deal with data ingestion, visualizing the outputs of data processing. There's a whole bunch of stuff. You need to control various things in your data processing framework. So at the time, the standard solution for processing big data was Hadoop, and the obvious choice was to use Hadoop for this. And it was considered, and the problem with Hadoop at the time was that it was a massive pile of Java software that was developed outside Nokia. There was no Java expertise in this small group of machine learning folks, and because of the problems with data and practice, it was expected that even if Hadoop was deployed, there would be some issues that we would need to patch, and then we would have to send those patches upstream, and it was going to be, we would have to become Hadoop developers in some sense or the other. So that kind of spawned one member of our team who was a hardcore Erlang hacker to say, I mean, how hard can this be? It's the MapReduce is simple, it's the maps, the reducers, you collect the data in one place and you're done. Right? And this, he did this, and he got the first version of Disco in 2 weeks over winter break. And since then, as he said, we've been getting it to scale through large clusters. So this is just MapReduce for processing big data in a nutshell. Big data is basically data that doesn't fit in the memory of a single machine, so you kind of need to use a cluster. You split the data into, across multiple machines in your cluster. You analyze pieces of it in procedures called maps. You get pieces of your results distributed across the cluster. You collect them in one place, perform a reduce, and you have your final analysis. Then the other aspects of MapReduce are moving data is expensive, so you move your computation to the data. To have a cheap cluster, you use commodity hardware, and then you really need to handle machines going up and down in your cluster. So you need a good fault tolerance strategy. So there are several aspects to implementing MapReduce. You need to deal with a cluster, you need distributed programming. You need to handle concurrent activities happening at the same time in your cluster, so you need really good support for concurrency. And you have to deal with machines going down, jobs failing, jobs needing to be restarted on different machines, so you need a good fault tolerance model. this is a perfect sweet spot for Erlang. So, which is why Erlang was chosen for the control domain. Now, this is half of the story. The other half is actually processing the data. And processing the data requires good libraries for parsing, log files, you need machine learning implementations, algorithms, and for that portion of Disco, Python was chosen. Turned out to be a pretty good choice, actually. It comes with battery Mundkur, it's really great. Unfortunately, it's slow. So recently, we've worked on a OCaml worker to process data for high-performance jobs. And other startups that are using Disco are now, there's one startup that's using Disco in production for financial trading that's developing a Java worker that's in progress right now. This is a Disco at a very high level on over the Disco architecture. There's a master node in the center. There are worker machines in the cluster. There's a Erlang node on each of them. These are the big blue circles. The green box is executable, a job packet that's sent from the client to the master, which distributes it to the workers. The job packet has an executable that's launched, and it communicates with Disco, with a local Erlang node on the worker, using a small library that implements the worker protocol. That's the small blue bullet there. The job packet accesses its data over various means, either using HTTP or on the local file system. And the worker protocol is specified in a way that you can implement it in any language. So this executable could be really any language. Now, for the executable to access data, you need to have data known at a known location. Now, classically, MapReduce uses a replicating distributed file system, so you have some tolerance for machines going down, so you have backup copies at other places in your cluster. And we tried using standard off-the-shelf replicating file systems. Unfortunately, for good reasons, replicating file systems try and hide where the storage is from the user. For obvious reasons, they want to move this data around transparently without you knowing what happened. Unfortunately, that is not a good interface for someone trying to implement MapReduce, because you really need to know where your data is, and so that you can move your compute to the data, so the data is open to the computation. So we ended up writing our own distributed file system. It's an extremely simple non-POSIX file system that has roughly the same architecture. It has master Erlang node and worker nodes on the rest of the cluster managing local storage. It's a very simple interface, JSON HTTP to the master and HTTP to the data. So now the standard question is when someone learns about Disco, why would they use it? How does it compare with Hadoop? And that's a really serious question. We didn't deal with this issue until recently, so we started benchmarking our benchmarking Disco against Hadoop. So one trivial benchmark is just word count on a 1 byte file. Now this involves finding out where the data is. So some metadata needs to be read across the file system. Find out where the data is located. The executable needs to be sent to that machine, started, launched, the executable runs, the data is fetched from the client. So all that's involved in this test. And you can see the completion times. P-Disco is the Python implementation of Disco, so there's a startup cost for starting the Python interpreter. O-Disco is native code, it's OCaml combined with native code, so it's extremely fast. And Hadoop, using Hadoop involves starting the JVM, so it's a pretty slow process there. These are some stats on our distributed file system. Reading and writing a 1 byte file, again, there's several operations involved in that step. You need to find out where the cluster to put that file, to put copies of that file. You need to store metadata about its location in the file system, and you need to replicate that metadata in the cluster. So all that's involved in this test, and the numbers again, highly in favor of Disco. And all this is using just the core Erlang control plane. Some read performance numbers across the whole spectrum of data file sizes. Disco is extremely fast. It gets pretty close to high data volumes. And for its, as you can see, it's really fast, and it uses a lot less CPU as well. Now the CPU is measured as system time plus user time divided by wall clock time. And so numbers above one indicate that the process is using threads. That's how you get CPU utilization within one. As you can see, the Hadoop file system is heavily multi-threaded for performance reasons, but involves excessive CPU use as well. This is the write performance. You can see some strange things happening in the write performance. Actually, what's happening is Disco is scaling linearly with file size. It's Hadoop that gets faster for some sizes of data. I'm not sure why that's the case, but it's Disco that's predictable, it's Hadoop that's not. I'm not sure why that's happening. But again, when it comes to CPU utilization, it's pretty clear that Disco doesn't use much CPU, it's just IO buffer. And this is an idea of how complex it was to implement this using Erlang, Python, OCaml compared to Hadoop. I mean, it's just orders of magnitude difference. It's interesting that David Beener's log count does not handle Erlang, so I had to use the Unix word count, which counts line code in Erlang, so that includes comments and other, including the license information in the file. So, the OCaml numbers are just for the bare basic worker protocol implementation. It's not counting any data processing libraries. And the Python implementation has not just the bare worker implementation, it has extensive libraries to help you to bootstrap while you're processing data. You can interface with DDFS and all kinds of things. So there's a whole bunch of utilities in the Python code, and it's still pretty small. So I'll just go into some experiences that we had in using Erlang. There's some really nice things about Erlang. The remote shell, the stylizer, which helps you catch type errors. And Erlang is known to be a dynamically typed language, and coming from an OCaml background, that makes my hair stand on end. But stylizer is an excellent tool to help combat those kinds of worries. And fprop is a pretty nice profiling tool. So the remote shell allows you to do stuff like this. You want to debug a live cluster. We have something called Disco Debug. You start that on your master. You get an Erlang shell. Your Erlang shell is now connected into all your Disco nodes. You can interface with any of the running processes in Disco. You can send them messages like get debug state. You can examine the live state on your cluster, see what's happening. It's excellent. Stylizer helps you fix bugs like this. And almost always, if you're not careful, you'll have problems with error handling code, because that really doesn't happen very often. languages like Haskell and OCaml catch these things, I mean, for obvious reasons, but you know, Erlang, it can be a problem, and you really need to use dialect to make sure all your error handling parts are clean. There's another thing that Erlang got. It's just a misplaced closing brace. You can stare for hours of that code and not realize that your brace is in the wrong place. So you really have good tools in Erlang to deal with problems like type safety, unit tests, and this is something that Disco hasn't really leveraged, and we plan to use these tools more extensively in our code base. This talk about the community is, for some strange reason, Disco flies under the radar just like functional programming languages do. They use in startups where they just want to get stuff working quickly. They don't want to deal with massive deployment issues. It's used in several, Austin Trading is a financial trading company. Chango is, does something to do with advertising on ad networks. Zivanta is, I think, a collaborative search company. So it's used in startups. There's an active community on the mailing list and IRC. The community is contributing. Great patches, Erlang Consulting, Austin Trading has its Java and Disco work in progress right now. And we just released our latest version of Disco yesterday with bug fixes and a massive number of patches from users. So just before coming to Tokyo, I sent this out to a few users on IRC, so it's a highly scientific study. And I asked them why they use Disco. So these were some of the comments. It was just painful to try and get Hadoop to work. The issues with Hadoop distributed file system and Disco just basically works. That's pretty nice to know. So I'll just conclude there and take any questions.
Still up to the developer to do that. writing a file system, but I imagine it's pretty difficult. So do people, do you yourself trust keeping your data in your custom file system, or do you also keep it copied on, you know, industry standard file system?
We have it only in our custom file system, and it's been explicitly designed for easy data recovery in case this goes down. So the data is copied into the file system without any modification at all. There's no chunking. What you put into the system is what you get on the local file storage. So we have some tools. We haven't released them yet that crawl the cluster and can extract files. So there's metadata as well as replicated on the cluster. So it's distributed metadata. And it's explicitly designed for this way for two reasons. It's easy for you to understand how the file system works by just looking at what's there in the local file system. And it's easy to recover files from it without this program. That's not really the case with the local. So, I mean, all of our